Penguin Random House Audio presents Skinship Stories by Yoon Choi. Read for you by Greta Jung, Intae Kim, Jennifer Kim, Soo Jean Kim, Raymond J. Lee, Kong Sim, Janet Song, and Jennifer Yoon. For my mother and father, and for Emma.
The Church of Abundant Life. Sue occupies the high stool behind the register as her husband, Jay, brings in the cartons of eggs, the infant formula, the glue traps, the dried beans, the little Debbie cakes, the single rolls of toilet paper, the strawberry cigars, the Jamaican castor oil, the yellow boxes of SOS steel wool, the cough syrup, the cereal, the hydroquinone cream, the little glass pipes of love roses, the foil-capped plastic barrel drinks called little hugs that their customers call grenades. It is a Wednesday. On Wednesdays, Jay restocks the store.
"Just see this," he says to her in Korean, setting down a final stack of boxes. "Would you just take a look at this?"
He takes a chosun ilbo from the top of a box and slaps it on the counter. She does not put up the reading glasses that she wears on a chain around her neck. Without them, she can only discern that what Jay has put in front of her is some kind of an ad. "Men," she says to herself in consolation. Sue knows that if Jay has a Korean newspaper, he must have dropped by Mr. Roh's corner store three blocks over. She can practically see the two of them, smoking and conferring on the concrete stoop. She knows their topics of conversation: the price of milk, North and South Korean politics, the Pennsylvania lotto. What worries her is when this talk results in a business idea. There was the time Jay and Mr. Roh drove back from the wholesalers on Broadway with a trunk load of weaves and wigs. She met the car at the curb with her arms crossed. There was just one thing she wanted to know. How much? $10,000, said Jay. Not to worry. They had used money from the kye.
$10,000?
The sum was so large that it didn't strike her conscious mind so much as her conscience. That was the thing about the kye. Jay saw it as free money, and she saw it for what it was, a revolving loan. She grabbed a wig and shook it at Jay. She said with passion that no woman wanted cheap fake hair. Even poor black women didn't want cheap fake hair. What women wanted was real hair, human hair, virgin Remy hair. And wasn't she right? Didn't those unsold wigs sit in their basement for years in black garbage bags until the mice got to them? She is moved to action. She drops off the stool, comes around the counter, and pokes through the boxes and bags that Jay has brought in. She puts on her glasses, but she doesn't address the paper on the counter. Instead, she holds up a jar of baby food and does a quick check of the ingredient list. Ground chicken, water, cornstarch. She picks up a carton of eggs, saying, "These aren't brown, right? Remember what happened with the WIC vouchers and the brown eggs?" Since these are not real questions but gestures, she doesn't immediately notice that Jay is not responding. The front door bangs open, and a man makes his way to the register.
"Telestial," he says,
and Sue goes behind the counter to unhook a calling card, which hangs on a pegboard beside the three-pack condoms. "Puerto Rican," she thinks automatically. The man leaves. Only then does she realize that Jay is in a state of absorption. It is so unusual for him to just stand at the counter, staring at a paper in the middle of a workday, that she looks at him sharply. Certain small things about him spring to her notice: the side-parted hair that he keeps a home-dyed black, the fishing vest with many pockets where he keeps coins, keys, a utility knife, and a lighter, the clearish cluster of asbestos warts on the hand beside the paper.
"Good old Kite," he says.
"That poor son of a bitch." She can't believe she has heard him correctly. Kite? Hong Kite?
She seeks her glasses at her throat and on the top of her head before realizing that they are on her face. She glances at the paper, and then, because Jay is there, she quickly looks away. She has not seen much more than the background of the ad, a small black and white speaker's photo, and the word revival, but she feels both excited and ridiculous.
Kite, the famous pastor, Jay says to her. Can you believe life?
She finds this a surprisingly perfect thing for him to have said. Can you believe life indeed? It captures for her that feeling of having encountered the distant past. She looks again at the speaker's photo and thinks that Kite has aged well, with dignity, all things considered. But after a moment's solemnity, Jay wraps the paper two times and recovers.
What's that thing we used to call him? Was it Monkey? Monkey Boy?
He stoops to pick up some boxes, giving her a sad view of the top of his head. When he straightens up, he is all business.
Mr. Roh has a guy who's getting him Newports at $38 a box from Delaware. $38? What do we pay? Almost 45?
And they're back. The old arguments, the ongoing themes in their long marriage. Please, she says, dismissing this with her hand. Just please. She finds it remarkable that in all the years they've spent together, 6-day weeks and 14-hour days, they still don't agree on right and wrong. She considers his attitude to be convenient and self-compromising, trying to get around attacks, continuing to stock those stoppered glass tubes that hold small paper roses. Everyone knows what those are, really. Get rid of the rose, add a little copper wool, and you've got yourself a crack pipe. Suddenly, Jay bolts. Sue knows, without looking, that the meter maid is coming. For decades, around this time, every morning, the meter maid in her three-wheeled vehicle comes down their street in fits and starts. When he senses her approach, Jay jumps into the Buick parked on the yellow curb, makes a series of left turns on the presidential streets, Washington, Hamilton, Grant, and then parks right back in the no-parking zone in front of the store. His store, his curb. There is no way to make him see things differently. With Jay gone, Sue returns to the ad. Revival, it reads. How to live an abundant life. Teaching by Reverend Hong Ki-tae. She looks more closely at the photo. A gentle, pitted face, silver glasses, white hair. It is, in fact, a little like a monkey's. Underneath the picture, there is a brief inspirational bio. Born 1946. Grew up in the village of Hengqi under Poduk Mountain. Attended Seoul National University. Further studies at Fuller Seminary in California. Author of such seminal works as Take This Cup and Out of Suffering Comes. There is no mention of the poor children. No mention of the wife. In a drawer somewhere, she still has the card she attempted to write when they'd learned the news. It was all over the Korean papers. It was reported that as many as 1 in 7 buildings in Seoul might be compromised. But in the end, she hadn't had the words. She hadn't gotten in touch, and neither, so far as she knew, had Jay. Incredibly, over the years, they had forgotten about it. And now, the door bangs open. The workday is made up of such interruptions. Seeing Rhonda Jones, who works in the bank up the street. Sue reaches overhead to the cigarette display and locates the pusher shelves for the Marlboro's blind. She has the pack on the counter before Rhonda, who has paused to catch her breath, has fully entered the store.
You know me, says Rhonda, laughing and gasping. Her rayon suit is stained under the armpits, and her teller's name tag pulls down the lapel.
Smoking is very bad, says Sue in English. When you go to quit?
I'm trying. Lord knows I'm trying. Rhonda sighs deeply as she opens an old-fashioned coin purse and roots for change.
After a moment, she gives up trying to find enough quarters and dimes and hands over a 20 that has been folded over and over into a small square.
"Tomorrow," says Rhonda as Sue hands over her change and her cigarettes. "I'm gonna quit tomorrow."
After Rhonda has gone, Sue returns to the ad. She now sees it differently, without sympathy or nostalgia. The picture of the large oak tree with many spreading branches. The topic of the revival, which is written...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.